Good morning. Welcome to Bethel Baptist Church this morning. Let's stand and open our service by singing Hallelujah, What a Savior.
Man of sorrows, what a name for the Son of God who came, ruined sinners to reclaim. Hallelujah, what a Savior. When he comes, our glorious King, all his ransomed home to bring, then anew his song will sing. Hallelujah, what a Savior.
Amen.
Oh, yes. Hallelujah. All right, Wednesday night crowd, what does that mean? Thank you. Glad to know that my eloquent teaching really sticks with you all. Yes, we have been looking in the book of Psalms, and we just got through with this section of Psalms called the Hallelujah Psalms, which means praise the Lord. And so, yes, that's what we want to do. And we come together here in God's house, and what a joy it is to see each and every one of you here today. And some of you have been out for a little while, but we're so glad that you're back with us. Some have been sick, some have been at home, some have been away. Wherever you might have been, we're glad you're back here with us. And especially if you're watching on Facebook, we say thank you for joining us, or maybe even in the parking lot. And so as we gather together today, we want to focus on the Lord and not our safe. Now, as you know, this is Vacation Bible School Week, and a lot of hard work has been put in to getting this thing ready, and you're going to hear more about that later on in the service. And so as we get ready for the service this morning, I just want to encourage you that if you're sitting on this side and you can't see the screen because the safe is blocking you, if you want to move over just a little bit on this side over here, the church is on a slab foundation, so we're not going to tilt, you know, all over. And I also want to tell you that if you want to move closer to the front, it's all right with me. You know, I won't spit on you much. And so come on down towards the front. And so as we get ready to worship our Lord and Savior, let's put our minds on the Word of God. Read with me from Psalms 34. Come, let us tell of the Lord's greatness. Let us exalt his name together. I prayed to the Lord, and he answered me. He freed me from all my fears. Wow, I love that verse of scripture. And he tells us, let us tell of the Lord's greatness. So here's what I want you to do right now. I want you to think about something that God has done great for you. You personally, something great. And I want you to turn around and look at least one person, if not two people, and tell them something great that God has done for you. Do it right now. And so now we want to exalt his name together as we pray and just thank the Lord for all that he has done for us and for the answered prayer which he has given to us. Remain standing for our prayer.
Let's pray. Our gracious, kind, and heavenly Father, we come to today just praising your name and thanking you that for all that you do in our lives. Lord, we come this morning seeking a blessing and to be a blessing to others. Father, we just pray that you'd be with this service. Just bless our pastor as he speaks today. Bless our music. And Father, may everything we say and do bring honor and glory to Jesus. For it's your name we love and pray. Amen.
Amen. Let's remain standing as we sing this song that talks about following God wherever he leads us. I will follow. Where you go, I'll go. Where you stay, I'll stay. When you move, I'll move. I will follow. All your ways are good, all your ways are sure. I will trust in you alone, higher than my sight, high above my life. I will trust in you alone. Where you go, I'll go. Where you stay, I'll stay. Where you move, I'll move. I will follow you. Who you love, I'll love. How you serve, I'll serve. If this life I lose, I will follow you. I will follow you. Light unto the world, light unto my life. I will live for you alone. You're the one I seek, knowing I will find. All I need is you alone, and you alone. Where you go, I'll go. Where you stay, I'll stay. When you move, I'll move. I will follow you. Who you love, I'll love. How you serve, I'll serve. If this life I lose, I will follow you. I will follow you. In you there's life everlasting. In you there's freedom for my soul. In you there's joy, unending joy. And I will follow. Where you go, I'll go. Where you stay, I'll stay. When you move, I'll move. I will follow. Who you love, I'll love. How you serve, I'll serve. If this life I lose, I will follow. Where you go, I'll go. Where you stay, I'll stay. When you move, I'll move. I will follow you. Who you love, I'll love. How you serve, I'll serve. If this life I lose, I will follow you. I will follow you. I will follow you. I will follow you. Amen. We can follow the Lord wherever he leads us, and then we will need to trust in him. Letting go of every single dream, I lay each one down at your feet. Every moment of my wandering, never
never changes what you see. I tried to win this war, I confess. My hands are weary, I need your rest. Mighty warrior, king of the fight, no matter what I face, you're by my side. When you don't move the mountains, I'm needing you to move. When you don't part the waters, I wish I could walk through. When you don't give the answers, as I cry out to you, I will trust, I will trust, I will trust in you. Truth is, you know what tomorrow brings. There's not a day ahead you have not seen. So in all things be my life and breath. I want what you want, Lord, and nothing less.
Sing it out now.
When you don't move the mountains, I'm needing you to move. When you don't part the waters, I wish I could walk through. When you don't give the answers, as I cry out to you, I will trust, I will trust, I will trust in you. I will trust in you. You are my strength and comfort. You are my steady hand. You are my firm foundation, the rock on which I stand. Your ways are always higher. Your plans are always good. There's not a place where I go you've not already stood. When you don't move the mountains, I'm needing you to move. When you don't part the waters, I wish I could walk through. When you don't give the answers, as I cry out to you, I will trust, I will trust, I will trust in you. When you don't move the mountains, I'm needing you to move. When you don't part the waters, I wish I could walk through. When you don't give the answers, as I cry out to you, I will trust, I will trust, I will trust in you. I will trust in you.
Misty made me do this to where y'all know how much she just loves getting up in front of people and everything. Well, this week is a week that has come with a lot of great expectations, anticipations, and aggravations. Has there been any aggravations?
Just a little.
Just a little? I mean, you can only expect that to happen, right?
Right,
yeah. You're not aggravated with me, though, are you?
Just thinking.
Golly,
a pastor that makes their children's ministry get in front of the church, that's kind of a mountain.
Yeah, well, if you'd hold that microphone up a little bit.
I don't want to touch my mouth.
No, no, just hold it up where they can hear everything. All right, this week, Vacation Bible School, and the theme is?
The Beatitudes.
The Beatitudes. Yeah. Now, the overall title of the Vacation Bible School is?
Upside Down Academy.
All right, tell us what Upside Down Academy means. Why was that name chosen? So, which, by the way, this curriculum, this event, is not a box thing that we ordered. This is creativity.
It was written by Donna Blakely.
The lessons are?
Yep. She wrote the curriculum for us, and we just kind of came in collectively and kind of come up with some stuff. But Upside Down Academy is, I guess the explanation would be, you know, when Jesus came and he told us to love our enemies or, you know, blessed are the poor in spirit, those are kind of things that the world is against. And to have an attitude like Christ is what the Beatitudes are about. Not a me attitude, but a Christ attitude. And he kind of flipped the world upside down. So that's where we came up with the Upside Down Academy idea from.
That's awesome. You know, and let me just plug this in right here. If we don't take the children and help flip their world upside down for Jesus, then into the world they go without Jesus. So I've been asked before, how important is VBS at your church? It is extremely important because it's one of those events that takes place where we have the greatest opportunity to be able to pour Christ into these children's lives and also to be able to meet their parents. And in Vacation Bible School, we've seen families come into our church, and so we're just so thankful for that. All right, now you talked about the Beatitudes, and to where, and Miss Donna wrote that. So run us through a little bit of what the kids are going to be doing each night.
So each night we'll have assembly, and then we will have our small group sessions, which they will learn about the Beatitudes, how to apply them to their life today. And then they will play games. We have an escape room. We have prepared an escape room. I don't know if anybody has ever been to an escape room before, but it's pretty cool. So, and then we'll have a closing assembly. We'll also have dinner each night for the kids.
Dinner?
That's all. Yes, dinner. Like food, not snack. Food.
Food. Yeah. Mm. Where's Mama at? She gonna be cooking some of that?
Yes, my mom. She's not in here. She's in the prayer room.
Okay. All right. Okay, now tell us, up here on the stage, you have a huge safe.
Yes.
And then you've got all this electronic looking stuff. Tell us about that.
Okay, so the academy, I came up with academy because we're teaching the kids about the Beatitudes and how to be a warrior for God, a soldier for God, because we're in a war. Every day we wake up, we're in a war. So my husband is a police officer, so I automatically went to police academy. So, and the vault, this is a vault, it's not a safe, it's a vault.
Pardon me.
This is where the Beatitudes are going to be kept. I just thought of like a spy, what a spy place would look like, and I just created like control panels out of cardboard. And
looks like something out of NASA.
Yeah,
that's for sure.
That's,
I wasn't sure if you were going to be launching kids out of here.
Yeah.
with all this or not.
No. But you know, that's what it is. And I have the Beatitudes
we'll
written
eject
over
you
there.
Out of space. Go ahead. So go ahead.
No, it's not. Well, Michael added the little music thing. I have no idea what it's called, but it looks kind of cool like that. I thought it was really cool. But nothing's functional.
Yeah.
It's just for show.
After the church service, if you want to come peruse up here, take a look at it, feel free to do so. We'll also have pictures on Facebook and to where we can see those things on Facebook and be able to share those things with you. All right. Tell us time, places, and ages.
Okay. Our age group is 4 to 12. Times will be 6 to 8:45, but we would like for children to start arriving around 5:30, 5:45, just to kind of get in here and get settled before
we'll start at
Michael
6.
Starts. Yeah, Michael okay. starts the assembly. And then what did you say?
And then
ages, time, place, here.
Here. Right.
In the sanctuary.
So kids will come here in the sanctuary.
Yeah.
And be picked up from inside the sanctuary.
Right. Well, we'll do like a school car line thing.
Right.
So parents don't have to get out of their car. They can just pull up and get their kid. And
And also, you can go to BethelGreenville.org, and you can pre-register your children.
Actually, pre-registers are closed.
Pre-register closed.
Right.
Okay, this is why we're having this conversation.
Right. We wanted to get an early kind of estimate, but you can register when you show up. So if you come tomorrow night and you show up, you can register that day. We're not going to turn you away just because you didn't pre-register.
Okay. All right. And then what else needs to be done that we as a church could help do?
There's not really anything else. We do have to set up the outsides, but I mean, that's not going to be difficult to do.
Okay.
It's pretty simple.
All right. Well, I've got a list of things that these people are going to need to do. So, you know, so okay. I didn't know if there was anything else you needed them to do.
Oh, no. I don't need them.
All right. Here's what I need you to do. First off, I need you to be in much prayer about this week. Folks, please understand, this will be fun for the kids. There'll be games. There'll be lessons. But this could be a life-changing event for the kids and also for their families. And so we really need your prayers over this. And so I want you to be praying for Vacation Bible School this week, please. Would, you know, and I make that as a plea, but I'm going to ask right now, if you're willing to say, yes, I will be a prayer warrior for Vacation Bible School, that I will pray for it daily, would you simply just raise your hand right now? And it's not that I'm going to count numbers, but the Lord sees those hands. And thank you. And thank you for being honest about it. You know, and so pray for the Vacation Bible School. And then also, I've been asked, how much is this costing? We don't know yet. We don't really try to. We have a budget, but when it comes down to something like this, I know Misty. I trust her. She's frugal. She's tight with the money, let me tell you. And so I think we've got less than $1,500 wrapped up in the whole thing.
Yes.
And that's phenomenal. And so this is how we use your tithes that you pay into the church. But also from that, if you would like to make an offering toward it, just mark VBS on it, and that's fine. I know some people, they love giving to offerings, to special projects, and things like that. So if you want to give, just mark VBS on your offering envelope and know that it will be much appreciated. And then also, if adults, if you could spare a little bit of time, and that is to be here around 5:30 and just be in the parking lot, and whenever the kids are being dropped off, if you could just be there to maybe help open a door, to, if it's raining, hold an umbrella, to be able to smile and wave at people and let them know that you're glad that they have come to Vacation Bible School, that would mean the world to me and to a lot of other folks. And so try to be here. Come early. And then it's over with at 8:45. And if you can be back here about 8:30 or so, just to be able to wave at them as they're leaving out, just to let folks know that are not normally in church or here at Bethel, that we really are friendly, you know, and we would love to see them back. So those are the main things I want to say. Anything else you wanted to share? Mm-hmm. All right. Well, let's take a moment now, and I want to ask you right now to just go ahead and begin to pray for Vacation Bible School, and that's our pastor's prayer theme this morning. It's just for you just to lift up VBS right now, the workers, the kids, the parents, and all the activities. Let's pray together. Father God, we just want to come and just say thank you, that Lord, that we can have Vacation Bible School here at Bethel Baptist Church. Father, what a joy it is to be able to see children, Lord, here in church, and Father, to know that this week, every day, Lord, there'll be children inside of this church. What a blessing. And so, Father, we come and we ask, Lord, that you continue, Father, to give us wisdom, leadership, direction, provisions, and protection. Father, we pray, Lord, that as we put ourselves before you and just say, here am I, Lord, use me. I thank you, Lord, for ones like Misty and her crew, Lord, that have stood up to the challenge and said, here am I. And Lord, thank you, Father, for how that you're using them. Now, Lord, use us as a church as a whole, and let us not see that this event is for somebody else or it's just for the kids. But Lord, it's for the entire church to be involved in this ministry and this mission. And so, Lord, we want to do all these things, God, keeping in mind that it is for your glory, for your honor, and Lord, for your kingdom's sake. Now, Lord, use us as you see fit, and Lord, just continue to give us, Lord, what we need to be able to accomplish, Father, your will and in your ways, and it's in Christ's name I pray. Amen.
All right, let's stand once again and continue our worship service through the singing of Seek Ye First the Kingdom of God and His Righteousness. Seek ye first the kingdom of God and His righteousness, and all these things shall be added unto you. Alleluia, alleluia. Ask and it shall be given unto you. Seek and ye shall find. Knock and the door shall be opened unto you. Alleluia, alleluia. Man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceeds from the mouth of God. Alleluia, alleluia. Amen. At the cross where I first saw the light.
Alas, and did my Savior bleed, and did my sovereign die? Would he devote that sacred head for sinners such as I? At the cross where I first saw the light, and the burden of my heart rolled away. It was there by faith I received my sight, and now I am happy all the day. Was it for sins that I have done? He groaned upon a tree. Amazing pity, grace unknown, and love beyond degree. At the cross where I first saw the light, and the burden of my heart rolled away. It was there by faith I received my sight, and now I am happy all the day. But drops of grief can ne'er repay the debt of love I owe. Dear Lord, I give myself away. 'Tis all that I can do. At the cross where I first saw the light, and the burden of my heart rolled away. It was there by faith I received my sight, and now I am happy all the day.
Amen. You may be seated.
keep fighting voices in my mind that say I'm not enough. Every single lie then tells me I will never measure up. Well. Every single lie just a sum of every high and every low. Remind me once again just who I am, because I need to know. Ooh, oh, you say you say of me, I believe. The only thing that matters now is everything you think of me. In you I find my worth, in you I find my identity. Taking all I have now, I'm laying it at your feet. You have every failure, God, you have every victory. What you see of me, I believe. Yes, I believe what you see of me, I
can you hear me now? All right. Let me invite you to take your Bibles and turn with me back to the book of Daniel. And We're going to be in chapter 3. We started chapter 3 last week, but we're going to look at the entire chapter today. You know, there are certain stories that come out of the book of Daniel that you can't preach the book of Daniel without making sure that you cover, especially with Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego and the fiery furnace. And that's Daniel 3. And we stopped last week just short of it, but this is where we want to pick up today. So let me just kind of remind you a little bit about what's going on here. Daniel and his friends were all in Jerusalem, living their life, but yet they were under the rule of the Babylonian ruler of King Nebuchadnezzar. Nebuchadnezzar wanted to grow his court of wise men, so he called for all of the young, good-looking, strong, smart young men to be brought out of Jerusalem and be brought into his court in Babylon. Well, among those was Daniel and his three friends that we know better by their slave names, which was Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. Now, when they got there, the king wanted them to be separated from their family, separated from their God, separated from their culture, and he put them through his academy. They were kind of sent off to his university. And they were expected to eat certain kinds of food and drink certain kinds of drink. And Daniel, you know, told him, you know, King, we don't want that. In fact, give us the opportunity to continue with our way and see how we turn out compared to how the rest of them do. And so as a result of this, they did very well. Well, Nebuchadnezzar then had a dream. Nebuchadnezzar wanted his wise men not only to interpret what the dream meant, but also to tell him what the dream was. So whenever none of them could, Nebuchadnezzar then sent out the order that all the wise men were to be killed. But Daniel pleaded and said, wait a moment, give us time. And so Daniel went to his three friends and they began to pray, and God then revealed to Daniel what the dream was and what it meant. He went back to Nebuchadnezzar, told him the dream, and also told him what he meant. Nebuchadnezzar was so impressed by this. He knew that it was from a deity. It was from the Most High God and not just some little g god. Well, as a result of this, Nebuchadnezzar decided he would build a 90-foot statue made of gold in honor of himself. And so he did. But he also said that there was going to be a ceremony of dedication. And this leads into us looking about three things, and that is friends, faith, and fire. And so from there, from Daniel chapter 3 is where we're going to begin today. And we're going to go ahead, even though we've already covered the first six verses, we're going to back up and read those again. King Nebuchadnezzar made a gold statue 90 feet tall and 9 feet wide and set it up on the plain of Dura in the province of Babylon. Then he sent messages to the high officers, officials, governors, advisors, treasurers, judges, magistrates, and all the providential officials to come to the dedication of the statue he had set up. So all these officials came and stood before the statue King Nebuchadnezzar had set up. Then a herald shouted out, "People of all races and nations and languages, listen to the king's command. When you hear the sound of the horn, flute, zither, lyre, harp, pipes, and other musical instruments, bow to the ground to worship King Nebuchadnezzar's gold statue. Anyone who refuses to obey will immediately be thrown into a blazing furnace." So at the sound of the musical instrument, all the people, whatever their race or nation or language, bowed to the ground and worshiped the gold statue that King Nebuchadnezzar had set up. But some of the astrologers went to the king and informed on the Jews. In other words, tattled on the Jews. So they said to King Nebuchadnezzar, "Long live the king! You issued a decree requiring all the people to bow down and worship the gold statue when they hear the sound of the horn, flute, zither, lyre, harps, pipes, and other musical instruments. That decree also states that those who refuse to obey must be thrown into a blazing furnace. But there are some Jews, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, whom you have put in charge of the province of Babylon. They pay no attention to you, your majesty. They refuse to serve your gods and do not worship the gold statue you have set up. Then Nebuchadnezzar flew into a rage and ordered that Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego be brought before him. When they were brought in, Nebuchadnezzar said to them, "Is it true, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, that you refuse to serve my gods or to worship the gold statue I have set up? I will give you one more chance to bow down and worship the statue I have made when you hear the sound of the musical instruments. But if you refuse, you'll be thrown immediately into the blazing furnace, and then what God will be able to rescue you from my power?" Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego replied, "O Nebuchadnezzar, we do not need to defend ourselves before you. If we're thrown into the blazing furnace, the God whom we serve is able to save us. He will rescue us from your power, your majesty. But even if he doesn't, we want to make it clear to you, your majesty, that we will never serve your gods or worship the gold statue you have set up." Nebuchadnezzar was so furious with Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego that his face became distorted with rage. He commanded that the furnace be heated 7 times hotter than usual. Then he ordered some of the strongest men of his army to bind Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego and throw them into the blazing furnace. So they tied them up and threw them into the furnace, fully dressed in their pants, turbans, robes, and other garments. And because the king in his anger had demanded such a hot fire in the furnace, the flames killed the soldiers as they threw the 3 men in. So Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, securely tied, fell into the roaring flames. But suddenly, Nebuchadnezzar jumped up in amazement and exclaimed to his advisors, "Did we tie up 3 men and throw them into the furnace?" "Yes, your majesty, we certainly did," they replied. "Look," Nebuchadnezzar shouted, "I see 4 men unbound walking around in the fire unharmed, and the 4th looks like a god." Then Nebuchadnezzar came as close as he could to the door of the flaming furnace and shouted, "Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, servants of the Most High God, come out. Come here." So Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego stepped out of the fire. Then the high officers, officials, and governors and advisors crowded around them and saw that the fire had not touched them, not a hair on their heads was singed, and their clothing was not scorched. They didn't even smell of smoke. Then Nebuchadnezzar said, "Praise to the God of Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. He sent his angel to rescue his servants who trusted in him. They defiled the king's command and were willing to die rather than serve or worship any god except their own god. Therefore, I make this decree. If any people, whatever their race or nation or language, speak a word against the God of Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, they will be torn limb from limb and their houses will be turned into heaps of rubble. There is no other God who can rescue like this." Then the king promoted Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego to even higher positions in the province of Babylon. Let's bow for prayer. Father God, as we have read your word, now we pray, Lord, that you would speak to our hearts. Father, revealing to us truths that which we might be able to take from it, to be able to live by it today, especially, God, in days like right now that we're going through. We pray, Father, that we would be inspired, encouraged, and instructed, God, and how now we should live our lives. Thank you, Lord, for preserving, Lord, your word for us to be able to read today and to be able to know you through it, and, Father, be able to know ourselves even better as well. And it's in Jesus' name I pray. Amen. The first thing that I want us to notice in this particular text are the friends. What you've got to understand is that all of us have friends. Now, please understand when I say this, there are people in whom you are just acquaintance with. You know, but because of the semantics of the word, sometimes we'll say, yeah, we're friends, but you're really not friends. You're just an acquaintance. And then there's a second group of people, and that is people in whom you're very much acquainted with, and they are your friends. And then we go one step further, and that is your very best friends. Now, I want you to understand something about having a best friend or friends. And that is, if you're going to have friends, you got to be a friend. And if you want to have a best friend, then you need to be a best friend. And understand this also, and that is that as many people as you might feel like that you're close to, really and truly, you might know lots of people, hundreds if not thousands of people. But yet your friends might only be in the hundreds or maybe even the tens, but your best friends are probably going to be no more than probably about three. Now you say, oh, I got more best friends than that. Really? Tell me about that. Because if you're really going to be a best friend to somebody, then it takes so much energy, it takes so much effort, it takes so much of you putting yourself into that relationship that you really do not have the time, resources, or energy to really spread yourself out beyond probably about three. Now, if you're retired and don't have anything else to do, you might be able to stretch that maybe to five. But even with that, though, that circle of that closest friends has got to be tight. Now, Daniel, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego probably were teenage friends. By the way, I want to remind you, these are still teenage young men. They were probably friends back in Jerusalem whenever they were brought into this encampment, this university, this academy of Nebuchadnezzar's, and they were forced to perhaps be friendly or friends with those who were very opposite of them in their religion and in their morality and in their purpose of life. Now listen to me. We as Christians, we have our morality, we have our religion, our relationship with God, and we also have our purpose in life. And if you really want to be best friends with somebody, you better be friends with whom have those same characteristics in common with you. If your best friend does not have those characteristics, then you need to reconsider really and truly who are your best friends. Because see, in our life, we're going to have those people in our life who will infect us. Now, I have used these points before, but it's still prevalent for this sermon, so just hang in here with me, because I tell this to a lot of people. And that is, you have people in your life that will infect you. Do you go out looking for infections? Do you like being around people and hugging up on them whenever you know they have an infection? No. If you find out that somebody has an infection, you probably want to pray for them at a distance. And if you have to get close to them, you probably want to glove up, gown up, and mask up before you get around them if it's a serious infection, right? But you know what the best thing to do if you're going to be around people that can infect you? Get away from them. I'm telling you, there's people in your life that are going to infect you and cause you damage, and they're going to cause you harm, and they can even cause you death. So think of those people as being like infection and get away from them. The second group is that of influence. You see, Daniel and his bros were all in this group of these infected people because they were not believers in God. They did not serve God. They were not in relationship with God. And they had their own morality, you know, and that was to bow down to Nebuchadnezzar because he was in their eyes God. But Daniel and his friends could not leave, and so therefore they said, you know what, we can't get away from the infection, but we're going to safeguard ourselves, and like I said a while ago, gown up, mask up, and glove up, so that what is going on around them is not going to get on the inside of them. Listen to me. You might have to work in an environment that is hostile towards Christians. But God may have you there for just such a time as this. But let me tell you, though, before you go in there every day, you need to have some time with Jesus. You need to pray. You need to meditate in His Word. You might need to call a Christian friend or the pastor and say, hey, I'm getting ready to go in here. I need some backup here. And whatever you do, you're putting on the whole armor of God to be able to go into battle with where God has you at this particular time, but not being in a place where you're going to get infected. But you also have those people in your life that can greatly influence you. Now, they can influence you for the good, or they can influence you for the bad. But a lot of that decision is going to be on how you perceive what they give you. The verbal, the nonverbal, the physical, whatever it is they give you, they can influence you. You ever been around people that you don't even have to talk to, but you can look and you can see on their face, they look like a mule eating briars, and all of a sudden you kind of get, you know, sad, you know, or you get around somebody like with Nebuchadnezzar, who's so angry that his face was all torted out of position, everything, and you see somebody that's angry, and all of a sudden, you don't know why, but now all of a sudden you're angry too. You've been around people like that? Yeah, you have. Some of you live with that person. Now, nonetheless, ooh, that was out loud, wasn't it? not me. I'm saying you. All right, now, but we also know that perhaps, you know, you might be in one mood, but all of a sudden you don't have to talk to that person, but you see somebody that might have a smile on their face. Are they humming a good song? Or you just notice they just got this aura around them that just kind of bleeds into you, and next thing you know, you're smiling. You know, you can be in a crowded room of people and be in one mood, and you can just hear somebody across the room say, "Go Vols," or "Roll Tide," and it just brings a smile to your face. Now, I'm saying they're influencing you. What, you know, Daniel's and his brothers, his bros, you know, they were all around these people that were trying to influence them. But they knew where the line was. And the problem in our society is the society wants to take the line away. And I'm telling you, you better draw a line in the sand. And you better decide on which side you're going to be on. And you see, and then the third group of people is those who will inspire you. You see, it is extremely tough to try to be an individual soldier in the Lord's army in a place that is filled with the enemy. But you know what? Whenever you have got somebody with you, it inspires you to be able to keep the faith and to be able to go forward and to be able to do what it is that needs to be done, because you feel like you got somebody that's got your back. And so the word inspire comes from the word inspiration, which means God breathed. You know, and so we need those close friends that can breathe a word of God into us. You know, to where you go to that friend and ask maybe for wise counsel, for guidance, for wisdom, for help. And that person tells you something. And even if it's not what you wanted to hear, it may be what God needed you to hear. And a real friend will not lie to you. A real friend will not tell you what you want to hear, but instead will tell you the truth. You know, if I'm just going to say this just so that I can wake you up. But you know what, though? All of us are prone to having surprises on our face. Some of us have bats that fly out of the cave and land on our face. Okay, some of us can get a booger on our face, okay? That's what I'm trying to tell you, okay? Y'all are like, huh? You know what? A real friend will come up and say, "Hey, bro." I want those friends in my life. What about you? You see, other people might would look and point. Did you see what he had on his face? Some people would take pictures of it and post it on Facebook. Look at what I'm standing next to. Booger man, you know. Y'all are with me today, ain't you? Yeah. I'm just telling you. Daniel, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego had the inspiration to do what they needed to do because God was using them in their relationship with each other to inspire each other to stay close to God and to do godly things and to keep serving the Lord. Who do you have in your life? Think about it. Who do you have in your life that will inspire you with God, to God, for God? And if you don't have anybody, then let me once again remind you of the importance of church. And this is the importance of our fellowship one with another. As Ken O'Ring and I and Jeanette were talking this morning about how many people that I know. And, you know, but my church family is where my bestest are. Because you're my family. Because, see, you inspire me as I hope I inspire you as well. And so we see these friends. Now I also want to remind you, are you the kind of friend that's inspiring somebody else? You know, I asked you a while ago, who have you got in your life? Let me ask you a question. Who has you in their life? It ain't always about, well, it was me. I just don't have anybody like that. Well, who do you have in your life that you help to inspire? But now listen to me now. You can't give inspiration to someone if you don't have some inspiration inside of you first. Because you can't give something that you ain't already got. Once again, the importance of worship and your time in prayer and your time in the Word of God daily. I got 41 guys that I send a text to every day, Monday through Friday, with a verse of Scripture in it. Several of those guys then send it on to their families and to their friends, and it's just mushroomed out. I don't know how many it's going out to now, but I got these guys that I send this to. And what I love is whenever one of these guys sometimes will say, hey, thanks for that text. Let me share with you a verse that I just read and send me something totally out of what we're doing. And it inspires me. And so let me just encourage you to be an inspiration to somebody and also have people in your life that will inspire you. All right, now let's talk about faith. Faith without works is what, church? So let's talk about faith. Faith will cause you to stand up. Faith will also cause you to speak up. Faith will also cause you to stay up. And I wanted to add a fourth one, but I forgot before church service. Faith will also help you to shut up. All right, so let me work through these four, and sorry the fourth one's not up there. First off, you notice that whenever Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, they were in a place that when they heard the music, they either stood up because the rest of the world was bowing down, or at best, they were still standing and stayed standing when the rest of the world was bowing down. And I want to remind you, there were probably thousands and thousands of people that when they heard all the musical instruments, stopped what they were doing and immediately bowed down towards this huge statue that Nebuchadnezzar had erected in his own honor for them to worship. Folks, in our day and time, the word idol is really only associated with a television show, American Idol. I like what Toby Mac says. We used to call them stars, now we call them idol. Now, the Bible warns us against having idols in our life. And we get confused because when we think about an idol, we think about a little statue like Buddha or somebody or something like that. But an idol is anything that controls you. An idol is anything that you give your allegiance to above your allegiance to God. You see, this is where something horrible can be an idol. It can be something that is immensely immoral or even illegal. But yet you give your attention to it. You give your allegiance to it. And it's more important to you than what God is. But the dangerous thing also is on the flip side. And that is, even good things can even become idols. Where our allegiance is first seems to be to our jobs. Our focus is only on our families. Our time is better, is always surrounded around the kids and their activities instead of on God. Michael had to sing a while ago, the Matthew 6:33 song, but seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these other things shall be added unto you. Now, what I want you to understand is that whenever you have a faith, it should not just be enough faith that's going to get you into heaven, but it ought to be a faith that leads you into a real relationship with God daily that will enable you to be able to stand up when the rest of the world is bowing down to their idols. But you can't stand up if you've got idols in your life. So what idols maybe do you have? I have to guard this in my own heart and in my own home. Because see, I don't go out and purchase a package that says home delivered idol, $19.95 plus shipping and handling. Call today. But QVC will sell you anything you want. Amazon's got it all. It'll be here tomorrow if you got Prime. Yeah. You need to have the kind of faith that will enable you to be able to stand up against all the stuff the world is trying to shove down our throats right now, church. Stand up for what is right. Which means you need to stand up and go to the polls and go vote. If you need a ride, let me know. If you want to know something about a candidate, I will be glad to share some sources with you. I'm not going to politic and campaign for nobody. But it's our responsibility as the church to stand up and be heard in this nation. Because see, this is one of the reasons why we're in such a mess today, is because enough Christians have not stood up and spoke up and stayed up. And whenever they haven't, you see what we've got today. So folks, listen to me. It's real easy for us to point and say, it's his fault, it's her fault, it's their fault. What about our fault, the church? It's a little more personal, don't it? But let me tell you, though. These Hebrew children were getting ready to face a fire. But the firing started whenever they got taken away from their church and brought into this foreign land and tried to be indoctrinated, and the fire started because they were going to have to stand up for their faith. And whenever they did this, those trials only seemed to have strengthened their faith instead of tearing it down. Because if you want this kind of faith, that you can stand up, speak up, stay up, and even know when to shut up, then that is a faith that is growing, not just a one-time event of you saying, yeah, I got faith. It's a faith that is growing, it's maturing, it's becoming more and more important to you. It's becoming more and more of what controls you, your faith. Now, understand this about the faith, and that is, I guarantee you, listen to me, I'm going to tell you something that you don't want to hear, and I'm going to tell you something that feel-good, ear-tickling, money-grabbing preachers won't tell you, but I'm going to tell you the truth. Your faith will always lead you into a fire. See, if I wanted to tickle your ears, if I wanted to make you feel good today and just tell you what you want to hear, I'll tell you about how that if you have faith, all your problems will be solved and you'll have the best life ever right now. And just send your money to Jesus and here's my address. That's what I would do. But I reuse the Bible when I preach. And I use the whole counsel of God. And here's what the Bible has showed me. Every single person that has had faith has had to go through a fire. Tell me one Bible character that you know of that did not have to go through a fire. There are none. You something to think about. Oh, if we just walk close to Jesus, then we won't have to go through any trials or tribulations. There were 12 men who walked with Jesus physically daily for years, and most of them became martyrs. So don't tell me your faith will keep you from fires. It will keep you from hell's fire. But trials, fire here on earth, no, it's only going to lead you into them. That's why Christianity is not for the weak. You know, and people talk about, oh, you know, to be a Christian, that is so weak. No, it takes a lot more fortitude and strength for you to stand up and admit in this world that you're a Christian now with the way they treat us than it's ever been before. Can I get a witness? Especially even at schools and in certain workplaces. But the fire, though. But whenever a fire comes to us, it's not meant to kill us. It's meant for God to perform a miracle. And one of the miracles is you know what fire is good for? It burns away impurities. So you see, whenever we go into the fire, it helps us to get right with God. We're baptized with fire. I mean, to where, you know, it's like, whew, you know. But unlike Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, I came out smelling like smoke. Because there was a lot for God to burn off on me whenever he put me through the fire. But you see, in this particular story, when they went into the fire, some would say, oh, if there really was a God, then, you know, those people would have never had to suffer like that. You know, they would have never been thrown into the fiery furnace. Here again, people who say that have never read the Bible. And they really do not know God. But instead, whenever God does allow us to be able to go through a trial, through a fire, it's usually because God is getting ready to perform some kind of a miracle. And you stop and you think about and through some of your life, some of the fires in which you've been through. Did you make it? More likely, it's probably a miracle that you did. I've told you before, it's a miracle because whenever God started burning some of the stuff off of me, I looked back and realized I could either be dead or in prison. And what would have got me there? Ain't none of your business right now. But I'm just telling you. And you know what? I can say that because 99% of you all, you're in the same boat I was in. If it was not for God, you'd be dead or in prison. Can I get a witness? If I'm lying, I'm dying. The only difference between those in prison and most of you all is they got caught. And some of you still going to get caught. Nonetheless, now, what I'm saying, though, is that none of us suit up and say, hey, today would be a great day for a fire to happen. No, fires happen whenever you're not expecting them. That's why it's important that before the fire ever starts, you've already got on your asbestos suit. So you'll be prepared for just such a day as that. It could be the loss of a job. It could be the loss of an income, a stock market crash. I know, talking to a friend of mine this last week, he talked about how much money he's lost in his retirement account. He's on retirement. It's like, you know, man, I hope something turns around real soon. It could be, you know, a lot of different things. But let me tell you also another fire that we get put into, and that is the sudden death of somebody. Today and tomorrow are two very significant anniversaries for me when it comes down to death. On this particular day, back in 1993, we were having vacation Bible school at our church in Sumter. And one of the little boys went home that afternoon and was playing baseball with his brother and his cousins in the front yard. And the ball got knocked out into the road and he went after it and got hit and killed by a car. 1 year ago tomorrow is whenever I witnessed the lady get killed right down here on the Swamp Rabbit Trail on a Sunday afternoon, the first day of vacation Bible school. And I think about those times, and I think about those two deaths so sudden, hit by cars in the beginning of Vacation Bible School. Yeah, y'all, I'm feeling the fire right now, because what it does to me emotionally, what it does to me, you know, spiritually and even physically. And I've got a dear cousin, well, the husband of a cousin of mine right now that's in ICU with a brain bleed, and they're not expecting him to live much longer. I hate death. But because of my faith where I walk with God, I don't have to like it. But I learn how to live in it. Because see, some people, whenever things happen in their life and there's a little bit of a fire, they run away from God. But just like with Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, when Nebuchadnezzar looked into the fiery furnace, he didn't see one, he didn't see two, he didn't see three. He saw four! And who was the fourth one? It was a man, Jesus. The Christophany of Christ alive, even in the Old Testament, walking around in that fiery furnace. About to get Baptistal on y'all. No, folks, that's what gets us through the fire, is when we realize that Jesus is with us even in those times. So there's a miracle there. But also when we go through the fire, there's a message that God wants to deliver through us. Because see, listen, as a pastor, I have to listen to people's stories. As a pastor, I have people that I need to go tell my story to. But the message of the story about the fires in which we go through should always come back around to Jesus. Because see, some of the fires that you have gone through, that you are going through, that you're going to go through, is because of your own stupidity, your own ignorance, your own hard-heartedness, and your own ill-gotten ways that got you into that fire. And then it's, come help me, Jesus. Just like, you know, I could have helped you before now, but hey, if it took a fire to get you to come to me, then hey, good. And then there's, so then what we do is we take those life experiences and we talk about how that God rescued me. Not about how you got yourself into the mess. As I always tell you, your testimony should never be about how bad you have been, but instead about how good God is. And that's the message. And whenever you are telling, you know, the story maybe about something you're going through that you have no control over, the message ought to be is, and God was still on his throne. And him I still serve. And so God lets fires come into our lives really to strengthen our testimonies. Because listen, if anybody else ever had to go through a fire, and you've been through that fire, you can actually then inspire somebody else about your fire experience, but the message being on what God did for you in it, through it, during it, and even after it. Y'all with me? Let's look at one more. A mansion. I had to think of an alliteration here, so I put mansion. Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego were saved from the fire. But not all Christians that go into the furnace are saved. Here in our world, there are Christians that are martyred every day. This last week in the news, in Nigeria, a young college girl passed her final exam. And she sent a text to a friend, supposedly, and praised Jesus that she passed all of her finals. The friend showed it to some authorities. The authorities then came, arrested her, charged her with blaspheming, killed her, and burnt her body. And you may say, well, why didn't God save her? He did. He gave her a home in heaven. Not because she was burned, but because of her faith that she already had in him before, and her acceptance of Jesus as being her Savior. So folks, like what Paul said, for me to die is to gain. And so folks, we're very blessed here in America. Chances of you being martyred because you're a Christian are slim, but yet it could happen. But know that we've got something so much better waiting for us on the other side. But where does it start? And that is, whenever we say, where he leads me, I will go. Even if it's into the fiery furnace. Where do you need to go today? The first place you might need to go is right here to the cross for your salvation. The other place is then be able to go with him daily. Take up your cross daily and follow him. And if you need help coming to the cross and knowing him as being your Lord, being your Savior, you come today. Meet with me after the church, even if you need to. If you need help with daily walk with him, reach out to me. I've got some things I want to share with you. Let's stand together as Michael leads us in this song.
I can hear my Savior calling. I can hear my Savior calling. I can hear my Savior calling. Take thy cross and follow, follow me. Where he leads me, I will follow. Where he leads me, I will follow. Where he leads me, I will follow. I'll go with him, all the
It's real easy whenever we want to think about following him and the road is smooth and the path is straight and all the scenery looks great. But what about when we have to follow him even into the furnace? Will you follow him? But the good thing about it is you won't be alone. You got friends, you got the church, but more importantly, you got Jesus. Let's raise a hand up to the Lord this day. The Lord keeps you from all harm and watches over your life. The Lord keeps watch over you as you come and go, both now and forever. And all of God's people said,
amen.